I'm often asked by younger filmmakers, why do I need to look at old movies? I've made a number of pictures in the past 20 years. And the response I find that I have to give them is that I still consider myself a student. The more pictures I've made in the past 20 years, the more I realize I really don't know. And I'm always looking for something or someone that I could learn from. Enrich your palette. Expand the canvas. There's always so much more to learn.
Hi, I'm Lawrence, and welcome to Watch a Green. Today we're going to talk about one of the greatest filmmakers of all time, Martin Scorsese. When you think Scorsese, what comes to mind? It could be his slower, more intimate films like Taxi Driver, or it could be his more extravagant, larger scale, rise and fall narratives of Goodfellas, The Wolf of Wall Street, or Casino. But what all of these films have in common? What can be found in almost every Scorsese film? What has become synonymous with his name among general audiences? Crime. If there's one thing Martin Scorsese loves, it's crime films.
Oh, the gangster film.
Organized crime, gangster genre.
We can see it in his first film, Who's That Knocking at My Door? And his most recent, The Irishman. Throughout his whole career, Scorsese has been fascinated by the mafia, by gangsters, by breaking the law, by crime.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
But this is only one side of his filmography. He also has films like this.
1633. Pax Christi, praised be God. Although for us, there is little peace in this land now.
Every now and again, Scorsese will make a slower paced, more spiritual film. He turns everything he's known for in his head. There's little in common between this.
All beings desire happiness. All wish to find their purer selves.
And this. Begging the question, what is Martin Scorsese's style? Every filmmaker has one. Tarantino has his signature conversational dialogue, and it can be found in a Western, a World War II movie, and a Kung Fu movie. Fincher's iconic color palette is evident in a dark and gritty murder mystery, and also a movie about Facebook.
That's what you said?
Nolan has his manipulation of time, Edgar Wright has his signature style of editing, and you can spot a Wes Anderson film a mile away.
Truly.
But what about Scorsese? What is his style? What specific things does he do in every movie he directs? Narratively, some of his films share common elements, but there's little you can find in both The Wolf of Wall Street and Silence.
Maybe this is not a story for a celibate priest.
What about voiceovers? Well, there's no narration in The King of Comedy, Hugo, or Shutter Island.
Oh, I don't know, Doctor. You tell us.
Long tracking shots is certainly a tool under his belt, but there's only one proper one in Silence, and it's almost non-existent in Taxi Driver. But let's pause for a moment. In order to understand Scorsese's cinematic style, we need to understand that Scorsese has a deep love and understanding of cinema.
Scorsese is so much film and love of film. I might be a better director if I just had dinner at his house every week and we just talked.
It's been a part of his life ever since he was a child.
You know, he always talks about him as this young man, you know, with asthma, with his father, watching film after film after film in a contained environment of the theater, and the drive to try to do something as great as all these people that he's admired for decades and decades, and he looks at this as the great modern art form.
And when it comes to film, he definitely knows his stuff.
Akira Kurosawa,
John Ford,
Kubrick, the great Italian director Sergio Leone.
You get the sense that he's absorbed every effective technique he's seen from a huge range of filmmakers. But most importantly, he understands why they work.
So how do you point the audience's eye to look where you want them to look and to get the point, the emotional and psychological point that you want to get across to them?
Scorsese didn't invent the long take. We can see it here in Touch of Evil from Orson Welles. In staying on this one shot, Welles ensures that we always know which car the bomb is in, so we relate everything that follows back to this sense of danger. Yet in Goodfellas, Scorsese uses the long take for a completely different reason. Goodfellas is a story about a man who always wanted to be a gangster. Nowhere is the seduction of this lifestyle more apparent than in this one shot. For Henry, life is smooth, fluid, and easy, and this long take is the perfect way to show that. Just like Karen, we're thrilled to be led down a back corridor into the life of a wise guy. And Scorsese wouldn't have it any other way.
I decided to do it in one take at maybe 10 hours to do. But we got it done. The shot that starts out in the street and goes through the entire place, goes downstairs, goes through the entire basement, goes through the halls, goes through the kitchen, all of this sort of thing. Then finally to the front, right to the front, right down to the dance floor. right there, and then he sent over a bottle of champagne for Mr. Tony, and so all of a sudden there's a drum roll, and who does it end on? Henny Youngman.
How are you all? I'm glad to be here. Take my wife, please.
Here in Raging Bull, we can see Scorsese use the dolly zoom. One of the first uses of this technique was done by Alfred Hitchcock in Vertigo. Hitchcock uses it to symbolize the main character's anxiety and fear of heights as he looks down from a tall building. In this case, Scorsese uses it for a similar purpose, showing main character Jake LaMotta's anxiety and confusion within the boxing ring.
Yeah, well, Vertigo is partially, it's in my DNA at this point. I just simply, it's a film that is part of my consciousness.
Okay, so what about voiceovers? Where did Scorsese get that technique?
The voice of the narrator, particularly in British films, particularly a top example is Kind Hearts and Coronets.
Henry took photograph after photograph, but seemed to have no urge whatever to follow it up with a visit to the darkroom.
It kind of clashed with narration in Italian and French New Wave films. And right around that time, I started to make my own films.
Yes.
It clashed, but it seemed to fall in place.
I found myself like always being drawn to it. Of course, I thought nothing of it. But like my eyes, always met it.
But these aren't the only cinematic techniques he relies on. What about the fast-paced, energetic style of editing he's developed over decades with editor Thelma Schoonmaker? It's in quite a few of his films, but by no means all of them. I would hardly describe this sequence as energetic, yet it contains just as much violence as the previous sequence from Goodfellas.
But I do come from a working-class family that had no books in the house, and there was no reading done. And so my learning of language was not literature, rather it was visual. It was through movies and films on television, and television, early days of television, the 1948. The impact the Italian films, the neorealist films, had on me when I was 5 or 6 years old never left me.
Scorsese's roots as an Italian-American are present throughout his filmography.
Take a few spoonfuls of tomato, throw them in here because your meatballs remain very soft.
Paulie did the prep work, and he had this wonderful system for doing the garlic. He used a razor, and he used to slice it so thin that it used to liquefy in the pan with just a little oil.
His upbringing is best reflected in one of his first films, Mean Streets. It combines Italian-Americans, crime, and Christianity to paint a portrait of New York that was undoubtedly familiar to the one he grew up in. Many of his films going forward would share similar elements.
Suck on this.
But after Goodfellas, he branched out. He cemented his reputation in Hollywood, and he changed from a simple New York filmmaker into a much more established name in the industry.
Well, Martin Scorsese is one of the movie world's really distinctive directors.
His budgets got larger, and he became an advocate for film conservation.
When we have to treat every last moving image as reverently and respectfully as the oldest book in the Library of Congress.
He also left New York and branched out into more worldly topics. Can you really imagine the Martin Scorsese from 1976 making Kundun?
Your Holiness.
Shutter Island and Cape Fear are tributes to classical Hollywood, Hitchcock in particular. It's clear he's moving away from his New York roots. Hugo doesn't have much to do with his life experiences, other than his love for movies.
We now have over 80 films by Georges Méliès.
Another big thing that impacts Scorsese's style is who he works with. Taxi Driver and Raging Bull are written by Paul Schrader, and they're both character studies of a troubled man with ultimately self-destructive behavior, and feature heavy violence shot in a handheld style. His collaborations with cinematographer Robert Richardson are the most colorful and extravagant, and his films shot by Michael Ballhouse feature more realistic lighting and colors. His early work with Michael Chapman has some of his most gritty visuals, and his recent work with Rodrigo Pietro is somewhere in the middle. Like any good director, he understands the visuals need to fit the story being told.
And the grammar is panning left and right, tracking in or out, you know, booming up and down.
The lavish lifestyle in Casino is reflected by the excessive lighting and vivid colors. The Departed and Taxi Driver are gritty crime films, so the visuals match that with more muted colors. And of course, his religious films have the most subtle visuals. Rodrigo Pietro himself admits that Scorsese wanted to be a lot more restrained when filming silence.
In fact, when we first started talking about it, Scorsese shared with me that he wasn't quite sure how to approach it visually. He felt that it needed a certain restraint.
Restraint. Scorsese is so rarely a director of restraint. But for Silence, and indeed most of his other religious films, there's certainly a calmer tone. The pacing slows down, and the violence is portrayed in a much less dynamic way. It's easy to relish in the shootouts of Scorsese's gangster work, but it's hard not to wince at the crucifixion scene in The Last Temptation of Christ. Jesus' approach is shot in slow motion to accentuate this pain rather than glamorizing the violence. Scorsese has deep Catholic roots. He initially planned to become a priest before he got into filmmaking, and like his Italian-American heritage, this is prominent throughout his work.
What they believe in was that at 12 o'clock at night, they went to church, they celebrated Mass, and after that, they came home.
Not only in his overtly religious films, but there's elements to it in almost all of his features.
But put a little piece there.
Is why Raging Bull, with no religious imagery, ends with some on-screen scripture. These Catholic roots manifest in a number of ways. Taxi Driver, Mean Streets and Goodfellas deals with themes of redemption, while Silence, Kundun and The Last Temptation of Christ portrays characters who affirm their faith in a world increasingly hostile to it. Almost every Scorsese character ultimately faces judgment or seeks redemptions for their actions or beliefs.
I thought for years about other ways of thinking, but my roots are here. I hope that there was a place that I could explore those roots and those feelings, I mean those roots and those thoughts and those contradictions in an intelligent way that's still within the Christian faith.
Scorsese is a film fan first and foremost, and part of why his style is so hard to pin down is because it's so eclectic. His influences are seemingly unending, and he utilizes and learns from every cinematic technique he's seen from a huge range of films he's been watching since he was a child. So to answer the question, what is Scorsese's style? We can look to a combination of his Italian-American and Christian roots that inform not only the moral fibre of his films, but also the imagery and stories he likes to tell. And then he picks projects he feels connected to and draws upon his extensive cinematic knowledge and filmmaking expertise to craft the story in the most effective way possible. Be this through the visuals, editing or sound design, Scorsese uses all aspects of the film form to elevate his work to a higher standard. But what underpins all of this, what has been a constant throughout his whole career and goes back to his childhood, is his deep love and understanding of cinema.
I think what makes cinema to me, I think ultimately it's something that for some reason stays with you, so that a few years later you could watch it again, or 10 years later you watch it again and it's different. In other words, there's more to learn about yourself or about life.
Mm-hmm.